Hello.
Yeah, Sean. Yeah, so I
Yeah.
saw him. Couldn't open the third one. I'm not sure which format that's in. So I actually saw a promissory note, and I saw a letter. Looks like you sent to a creditor. Looks like that was in regard to an accepted for value. But the third document, for whatever reason, I was unable to open it. Which format did you send that in?
I thought it was a PDF, but I
No,
guess
it's not a
not.
PDF. I couldn't open that one. What was that one regarding? The first two
So
looks
that
good.
right, the response was from, or that was from the student loan servicer Navient, and in that document they basically said that my, and I'm gonna pull it up here so that I can read it verbatim. One thing that I did, I don't know if you saw it in my email correspondence earlier, is I just politely and respectfully asked that this phone consultation not be uploaded to YouTube. I mean, I understand that you do a lot of work there, and there's a lot of consultations that you do have uploaded. But I politely and respectfully request that you do not upload this one. Let me see.
Yeah. You still there?
Yes, I'm still here. Oh,
So, I mean, you were still reading something, or?
I'm trying to put, okay, so here it is. So it says, this letter is in response to your recent inquiry regarding the loans listed below. Your correspondence appears to make a legal claim, sometimes referred to as redemption, straw man, or accepted for value. We do not recognize these claims as valid under state or federal law. Several federal government agencies have issued public warnings that these claims are frivolous and are often associated with fraud schemes. We apologize if we have misinterpreted your inquiry. Please contact us to clarify the nature of your inquiry if you did not intend to make such a claim. And yes, so for your reference, our role as a federal student loan servicer is governed primarily by the terms of your promissory note and by the Higher Education Act of 1965. But they did not agree. From what I have been studying, is the documents that I provided them was one, a remittance, and two, a contract stating that they had to abide by certain things or respond to certain things in a certain way, or else it would be, or else the contract and the remittance would be deemed accepted. Their only correspondence has been this letter, which does not make any statement saying that they did not, just saying that these claims of different terms are not valid, but they didn't say anything in regards to the actual remittance. However, they have not credited my account. They have not sent me a receipt for the remittance, nor have they, return the remittance either, which is something that was, a statement that was put in the contract that if you aren't going to accept this, then you do have to return it by mail. So I am coming to you asking for advice in regards to the next steps. Now, I wrote out a letter as because I don't want to go into acquiescence. So my intent was to write out a letter reinforming them that they are in breach of contract by not returning the remittance, and that they have not, you know, credited the account, and then making them aware that the documents that I provided have no mention of strawman redemption or acceptance for value, but that they do refer to United States public policy, international law, and contract law. I know that you cannot give legal advice. You're not, everything that you do is for educational and entertainment purposes. But if there were some suggestions that you would provide, am I on the right track?
Yeah, well, you know, first of all, giving all praises to the Most High, Yahweh, the God of our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'll say this, like, I noticed you used the word advice. I don't know if that was done inadvertently, but I don't offer any kind of advice, legal or otherwise. I just tell you how I've actually handled a situation in the past or would handle that particular situation, but can't suggest that you do it. You know, you do so at your own free will. Now, one of the things that, now, let me ask you this. The letter that you had me read, was that the letter that you sent them?
Yes, I did send that to them along with the promissory note. And then their response was the response that I had read out to you.
Right. So the letter, it was very well written, but my recollection of the letter is that one of the things that I would have actually added to that letter is that I would have given them 10 days to respond. Why would I have given them 10? Go ahead.
I put that in the fine print of the promissory note, is that they had to respond within 3 business days or 72 hours.
Well, that's not sufficient. And let me tell you why. That's not sufficient. Now, the reason I say that's not sufficient is because you have 72 hours in truth and lending for any kind of transaction of a security entrance to be valid. So that's 3 days for the contract itself to be valid. That's your offer that you're sending them. So in any kind of court of law, they would consider that to be unjust because you only gave them 3 days. Now, typically the way that you want to handle that is how I was going to explain. You want to give them 10 days. Why 10 days? Because you want to give 3 days for them to receive the mail. You want to get 3 days for the contract to be valid after they receive it, and you want to give 3 days for them to mail the mail back, plus a Sunday, which is actually a total of 10 days, which is reasonable. Now, something less than that may not consider to be reasonable in the eyes of someone that's actually trying to bring justice forth, because they could just respectfully suggest, well, you didn't even give us time to respond. You gave us only 3 days, and that was only enough time for the contract to actually be valid. So they could say, you know, they could argue we didn't have a substantial amount of time to respond. So I'll always give them at least 10 days.
Okay. Now, going forward, because since they consider my claims to be invalid,
that's an offer. That's an offer. See, I mean, that's, to me, they're making you a counter offer. Now, according to HJR 192 and Public Law 7310, which I would have actually affixed a copy in there. I usually send a copy of that when I actually did an acceptance of value. I would put in a copy of HJR 192, because if they're not familiar with it, I would actually allow them to familiarize themselves with it so they could see I'm not making that up. Now, for them to say, well, we don't accept that, well, that's not my problem, because according to UCC 3-603B, it says if a tender payment is actually sent to someone and they keep it, then there is discharge, from which you've told me they've kept it. But it also even goes further to say in UCC 3-603B that if they don't keep it, if the person
that's actually rendering that tender payment is qualified, then they're still discharged, even if they send it back. Why? Because you made them a valid offer, and if they decide not to keep it, then that's on them. This is according to the UCC. It's written right there in black and white. I don't make this stuff up.
Oh, no, brother. I know you're not. So I just took note of that UCC so that I can add that in my correspondence that I will send, that I plan to send back to them.
Are you in front of a computer right now?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. Google UCC 3-603B and read that for me. I want to make sure you clearly understand that and see why they really don't have an option and show you why the A for V must work. If it doesn't work, then they're creating a fraud, especially if this is an organization on the public side, and if it's a student loan, then they're definitely on the public side.
Mm-hmm. I'm pulling that up right now. UCC.
See, UCC 3-603B.
Yep, my internet's just being a little bit slow.
And this is the problem.
Okay, here we go. UCC 3-603, tender of payment. A, if tender of payment of an obligation to pay an instrument is made to a person entitled to enforce the instrument.
Okay, hold on. The person entitled to enforce the instrument, I want to make sure you understand this. That would be the CFO or whoever handled the financial affairs to that company. This is why I always send it in to the chief financial officer. If they don't have one.
That's who I did.
Okay, go ahead.
The effect of tender is governed by principles of law applicable to tender of payment under a simple contract. Tender of payment of an obligation to pay an instrument is made to a person entitled to enforce the instrument, and the tender is refused, there is discharge.
See, they're still discharged. So even though that they're telling you that they, well, we don't accept that, they're still discharged.
Absolutely, yes. I'm definitely, okay, I'm putting this in my correspondence. And then, so from that, from after I mail in this letter of correspondence, I need to, if this is something that you were doing, you would, in your shoes, do 10 days. You would give them 10 days.
Yeah, we'll give them 10 days from, the initial letter. But I'll tell you this also, brother, they've already accepted it, because if you look up acceptance in Black Law's dictionary. If you send someone something and they don't send it back, that's acceptance, which actually forms a binding contract. This is why.
Exactly. That's why I pointed out my breach of contract, because they haven't returned it.
Right.
Because they haven't returned the document. That's like me. Giving you another form of legal tender and you keeping it and then just responding and saying that my claim is not valid. I'm like, you can't do that. But I will mail this. I will add that section that you pointed out to me. And so now you're saying that they have accepted it, but I haven't seen any change in.
I'm not saying they have accepted it. The law says that they have accepted it, because if you send a document to someone, an offer, and they keep it, then there is acceptance. And the only thing you need to know about acceptance is that it forms a binding contract. So my response, if I was you, when I respond, along with the other stuff that you're sending, I would affix a copy of the original document that you initially sent to them. You know, the remittance. Yeah, I would affix a copy of that remittance and say, I received your notice, whatever date that they actually sent you this notice and that they don't accept it. I would say something along the line, I received your notice that we'll receive on May. Something dated herewith, which was accepted. When I sent them my remittance, which was accepted. So if they accepted it, then they agreed to the terms of the contract, by acquiescence, by not responding or sending your document back, because you stipulated in the terms of your contract that if you keep this, then there's acceptance. There's a binding contract. So they entered into a valid contract with you. So I would say something along the line that, if you mistakenly or inadvertently refuse this, or you're sending this out by mistake, then please make the adjustments to the account, because it was essentially accepted because they kept it, and you stated in your offer, if you accept it, then there's an agreement. And if there's an agreement, it forms a binding contract.
Yeah. Okay. All right, that I will do.
I got one question for you though. Who wrote you the response? The person that wrote the response, was it the CFO?
No, they didn't put a name on it.
Yeah. So it's just some electronic generated letter. You know why there's no name? Because no one wants to assume the responsibility
of being in breach of contract.
Right. That's why there's no name. And these are the little things that people need to learn to look for.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, so I think I'm making great strides with this. There was just some other quick topics that I wanted to talk to you about, because I know you probably don't remember me, but we did have...
No, I remember you. I remember you. Thanks.
Okay. I wanted to, and this is just kind of like helping me, study and grow and learn. But in regards to the becoming a secured party creditor, I know that you will be able, and I think I have this right now, but you will be able to discharge debt on the private side. Is that
correct? No, that's incorrect.
Okay. On the public side, then.
Right. HJR 192 specifically says public debt.
Okay.
Private is like between you and I. If it was on the private side, that means for all of my time and energy, you could just simply render me and accept it for value and say, hey, just accept this for value. But that's not how it works on the private side. Like if you mow my lawn, that's what the greenbacks are really for, because you and I did not create or accumulate the debt. The corporations did, and the federal GOV.
Okay. And so from now, with that, after you change your status and become a secured party creditor, are you still able to acquire new debt on the public side?
Yeah, you can. Because of the Constitution. Article 1, Section 10, Clause 1 says no state could pass any law impairing the obligation of contract, which means you still have a right to contract. Now, the thing with that is that there's certain, people that you put on notice that, that's what the whole A for V is for, that if you accumulate debt, you discharge it, you set it off. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I guess this is like a very like generic example, but essentially then once you become a secured party creditor, anything that you contract with on like a credit card or just use that as an example, will be discharged at the end of the month, or can be discharged at the end of the month.
Well, if you, you know, accept it for value correctly, then yes.
Right. Okay.
That means responding to their offers appropriately, not acquiescent or not getting into an argument with them. They have an attorney in their department, and attorneys argue. And they argue in languages that most people just do not understand.
Okay. But you would, like, mail your bill of exchange to the CFO every month, essentially.
Bill of exchange for what?
So, like, the, like, any type of, like, statement that you get, your, like, your, any of your utilities, phone bill, credit card bill, or credit card statements, phone statements, things of that nature would be, you would respond to them with a bill of exchange. Is that correct?
Well, I use the A for B with that.
Okay.
I use the A for V for that.
Okay. If you don't, I'm just curious, why would you use the A for V as opposed to a promissory note or a bill of exchange?
Well, debtors use promissory notes. Creditors use bills of exchange. I'll use a bill of exchange or something, maybe if I'm trying to set off something on a home or something like that, like real property.
Okay.
But the promissory note is generally something that's used by a debtor.
Okay. So, well, I guess why would you use a bill of exchange for real property as opposed to a phone statement?
Oh, it is my will. But I've actually used an accepted for value on a foreclosure before. But it is just my preference to use a bill of exchange on something like that.
Okay. Just personal preference, or is there any benefits?
No, just my personal preference.
Okay.
The promissory note is equivalent to, the dollar bill. Like a promise to pay when money returned in the circulation. Same thing as a dollar bill.
So you basically want to, like, limit the amount of time that you use that?
No, I mean, if that's your preference, then you could use that. But the bill of exchange is, I'm actually making an exchange with whatever it is that you actually have to offer me.
Right. But, like, for example, if they accept, so if the student loan department accepts the promissory note that I sent, when the gold and silver comes back into circulation, then I would be subjected to pay them with the actual gold and silver.
Right.
And then for the bill of exchange, you would not?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't owe them anything. But I think it was pretty crafty on how you decided to use a promissory note instead of an A for V to try to settle off a debt. I mean, are you a creditor? Or you are
No, at this time I'm not.
So I would surmise that's your strategy for using a promissory note, because debtors use a promissory note. That's just like, you know, me coming to put a greenback in your hand and say, here, take this. Until real money comes into circulation, this is the medium of exchange. That's basically what your promissory note is suggesting. And that's what the A for V is saying also. But only with the accepted for value, you're exempted from levy. Which means, hey, if I'm a creditor, according to what they have on their books, I'm under no obligation to pay their taxes. I'm exempted from their levy, but I can do so voluntarily because it goes back to the Constitution. Article 1, Section 10, Clause 1, no state should pass any law impairing the obligation of contract, so I still could actually contract that away.
I see. Now, in regards to the when you become a creditor, I was listening to some things that suggested as to, and they mentioned that it was very like advanced, but establishing a business trust as well. Along as supporting documentation for your with your other paperwork, and that made me claim that it might be possible to you know, get like funds or something like that from it. But I guess I was just wondering if you could touch base on what, how you would need to like set up the business trust, or like things that you need to like have established in order to send that documentation in.
Like, I mean, what do you mean when you say like a business trust? Because when you become an SPC, essentially you are setting up a trust. You're setting up a trust between you and the debtor. You're putting a lien against all of the debtor's property. So, I mean, if you're doing a business, then you would actually manage the business in your corporation's name, which is the debtor. And then me, I would actually use an EIN number for that particular business. So, I mean, that would actually be my trust. But in terms of actually setting that up, it's a pretty long process. That's something that I would actually be able to explain in this short phone conversation. But there is certain documents that I would actually put on the record to actually set up that trust. In fact, I would set up an unincorporated business trust. I would just not incorporate my trust. I would make it an unincorporated business trust.
Okay.
Because moment that you corporate, guess what? You're going back into the system, and now you're gonna have to play by their rules.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard like the term of, and maybe I should have been more specific, but like a common law business trust. To supplement your SPC documents, but I haven't gotten into that form of study yet. So I didn't know if there was anything you could touch base on that, or even if you have any documents that you would suggest studying from in order to like learn more about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, the whole secure party creditor thing. Like, you know, there's certain documents that you actually got to file and put on the record. You know, it's a lot of documents to properly set up that trust. It's pretty long. That process is almost as long as you know, the process for the secured party creditor.
Right.
Okay. So, I mean, it's a pretty long process of, like, drafting that stuff up.
Okay. All yep. right. Well, I know had a little bit of time left. I was just thinking if there's anything else that
What was that, brother?
I'm sorry.
No, I thought you said something. I heard you say something.
Oh,
you said...
no, I was looking at the time to see how much time I had left for today's call or consultation.
Yeah, we got about 6 minutes.
Right.
I think we talked about 3.5-4 minutes the first time. So yeah. Would you have some more questions?
No. At this time, I think I'm good. I will. I was just trying to, I guess, just get a little bit better understanding of the like accepted for value and the exemption from levy. Now, in your like as a secured party creditor, do you still take loans in like on the basis of your like credit or your social security number? I guess just trying to figure out how that, you know, like if you were to like get a new car or something like that, I guess you would still have to qualify for the loan. Is that accurate? And then
you would be able
to discharge it by a accepted for value exempt from levy letter?
Yeah, I mean, if you do it effectively, you know, I don't want to say just anyone could do that because, you know, there's some people, they become secured party creditors. They put documents, you know, on the public record, but they don't clearly understand why they did that because they didn't do any research or reading prior to that. And I always told people, understand what that read is. Understand what that read is. And most people don't. They just want to rush in and do, oh, I want to sit off that. And I could tell you, most people want to become secured party creditors to discharge debt. They don't care that, well, I'm no longer under the jurisdiction. They don't care I'm exempted from levy. They don't care about that stuff. They just want to discharge debt. So all of their energy is going towards that, you know, trying to, you know, discharge debt. And they really haven't learned the things that was necessary to be effective at discharging debt or any of the other benefits of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will have to, is there something that, like, any text that you recommend that I can read on the, like the meaning of exemption from levy and how that applies? Because I definitely do want to.
Well, if you know what I would suggest is that you would actually define the word levy in a Black Lord's Dictionary, because once you have an understanding or overstanding of what the word means, then you would understand why you're exempted from levy with the secured party creditor.
Right. Okay.
So you got to understand what levy truly means.
Okay. And that I'll look that up in my fourth edition, Black.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. All so right. in my spirit, or at leisure time, when people are watching TV and so on and so forth, Like, I'm usually reading a book, or I'm studying, or trying to find out, how can I make myself better? How can I become more knowledgeable at this? How can I actually grow and expand? And then people say, well, what do you do? What do you do for fun? Whatever. I say, I grow. I get enjoyment from growing. I get enjoyment from growth. I get enjoyment from success. I get enjoyment from being free, having that freedom of being able to pick up and go anywhere I want to go and don't have any boss or anyone to tell me, oh, well, you got to be here, or if you're 3 minutes late, even though if I've actually been to work every day on time for 5 years, if I show up a couple times late, they're threatening to fire me, and then all of that goes down the drain? Come on, man. I'm just not built like that. I'm not designed to work for anyone like that, man. So my, you know, my pleasure in extracurricular activities outside of martial arts and a few other things comes from me enhancing my growth and soaring to new heights. You know, where everybody else is sleeping, Tiger Doc is up studying and reading almost until he fall out, you know. That's how you get ahead, man. That's how you be great. You know, I'm trying to leave a legacy of something behind. So I'm just still growing. I'm trying to leave a legacy, man, all over the world. That's my ultimate goal, and to try and reach as many people as possible and wake some people up and try and make a difference in people's lives.
Hey, Tiger Duck, well, I'm going to let you go because we're getting close to that time, but I'm probably going to end up scheduling another consultation with you in a couple weeks when I get paid.
All right, brother.
All right, take care.
All right, Sean, you too.